So the title of our sermon this morning is Set Apart for Safekeeping. Set Apart for Safekeeping, and this is part three. If you are visiting with us or new here, maybe you're just entering into this sermon series through John, we as a church together have been working verse by verse through the Gospel of John on Sunday mornings. And we're in John 17. As you come to John 17, you're in the last hours of the Lord's earthly ministry. Judas, the traitor, the betrayer, has left. And the Lord and the 11 have left the upper room now, and they're making their way through the city. And in chapter 18, verse 1, they go out of the city, they cross the brook Kidron, and they enter the Garden of Gethsemane. So you see where this puts us in the narrative given here by John in the Gospel of John. The Lord's primary focus here to this point is not on the brutality of the cross that lies before him, as you might expect. The cross lays just ahead. He's going to endure the brutality of the cross. But as we come to this text of Scripture, his focus, his concern, is on these 11 men who are with him. And as he prays, praying for them, his focus on them and also on all those who would believe in him through the word that they preach. He's taught them through this text. He's taught them love and humility in the upper room as he met with them, right? He's encouraged them with promises of peace, encouraged them with promises of joy, the gift of the Spirit of God. And as they've been walking along together, he's charged them to abide in him and bear fruit. He's warned them of what their ministry will be like in this wicked world. And now, in John chapter 17, as he prays, he said all that he's needed to say to them. He's given them good instruction, parting words. His time with them is coming to an end. So he now, in his prayer, commits them to God. He commits them, his disciples, and all true disciples who would ever believe in him through their word, he commits them to the loving care of God the Father. Why is that? Why does he do this in John 17? Well, quite simply, it's because we need keeping. We need sanctifying. We need to be held in the grip of our Heavenly Father. These men walking along right now with him are a picture of us all, aren't they? They're a picture of all of us. In a room this size, there's likely a Judas here, isn't there? The rest of us, often weak, often fearful, often faithless, often doubting. We've abandoned him, haven't we? For far less than a garrison of troops in the garden, haven't we? We've denied him in the face of far less than a servant girl in the high priest's courtyard, haven't we? So what you see in the Lord's prayer here is certainly not any confidence in them, not any confidence in them or in us. But what you see here in the Lord's Prayer is a total and complete confidence in the power of God to keep and to sanctify his own. That's you and I if you're in Christ. We can't keep anything ourselves, right? There are many in this room who couldn't keep a plant, right? I couldn't keep a goldfish, much less my soul, much less faith in the Lord. We can't sanctify ourselves. We can't preserve ourselves. We can't make it to the end of the week apart from God, much less to the end of our lives. Apart from him, we can do nothing. Got choking thorns on the right hand, tribulation, persecution on the left, the cares of this world, the deceitfulness of riches, right? The wicked one swooping in, snatching away the seed. So in John 17, as the Lord prays, the concern of the Lord is for the difficulty of our commission in this world. The difficulty of it. being a witness for Christ in a world that hates Christ. And so the Lord prays in John chapter 17, verse 11. He prays, I'm no longer in the world, but these, mine own, my precious, prized possession, those whom you have given me, Father, out of the world, these are in the world. And I come to you, Holy Father, keep through your name those whom you have given me. In eternity past, God the Father, seeking in love to glorify God the Son, chose a redeemed people to give to God the Son to worship him and to serve him. As Jesus says in John chapter 17, verse 12, he says, while I was with them in the world, I kept them in your name. God the Son kept them. God the Son preserved them, and now he goes to the cross to die for them. So he prays, Holy Father, keep them. Keep them. Keep them spiritually safe from the dark influences of this world. Keep them in the faith. Keep them devoted to you. Preserve them to the end. Keep them from the evil one. Now, Jesus had told them, whatever you ask the Father in my name, he will give you. And what do you think that means for prayer requests to the Father on the part of God the Son himself? He certainly gets what he asks for, right? We know that. We trust that. We believe in God for that. And so this prayer is an encouragement to you if you're in Christ. He says in verse 13 that he prays this for them in their hearing so that they might have his joy fulfilled in themselves. As we come to verse 14, there's a subtle shift in his concern. They're going to have to live for Christ in a world that despises them, that shows contempt toward them, that is hostile toward them. He says in verse 14, I have given them your word. And the world has hated them because they're not of the world, just as I am not of the world. This world is hostile to them. The world is hostile. The devil prowls around in it like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. There are casualties of the war strewn out all over the place. Stephen would say in Acts chapter 7, was there ever a prophet your ancestors didn't persecute? They even killed those who predicted the coming of the righteous one. And now you have betrayed and murdered him. And that was just before they picked up stones and murdered the first martyr of the church. This world is hateful and hostile. They're hateful toward, they're not indifferent toward Christ. They're not indifferent toward the grace and mercy of God in Christ. Anyone who even appears to be indifferent is hateful. Jesus prays for them, and he prays for us. Then in John chapter 17, verse 17, Father, sanctify them by your truth. Your word is truth. By means of your word, separate them from this wicked world to yourself and hold them, keep them. He says, I'm not praying that you should take them out of the world, but keep them set apart to you, Father. Consecrate them. Devote them entirely to you and make them holy. Preserve those whom you have given me, those who make up the church, right? The bride of Christ, that I might one day present her to myself, a glorious church, not having spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that she should be holy and without blemish. He prays, Father, keep them. Father, sanctify them. You know, sometimes we consider the church, we consider Christianity, we consider our own weakness, we consider our own faith, it appears to be such a fragile thing, doesn't it? 11 men against the world. The church against the world. Sometimes it feels like you and I are against the world, doesn't it? But we are, by virtue of the prayer of our Lord and the grace of God, we are kept by the power of God. We are sanctified by the work of God through the word of God. And true saving faith is not a fragile thing. True saving faith is a victorious thing. It is a conquering thing. It is preserved by the power of God. It is cultivated by the work of God. It is strengthened and fueled by the Spirit of God. It is informed by the inviolable Word of God. It is authored and finished by the Son of God. Faith is the victory that has overcome the world. And we are set apart or sanctified to God and safely kept by His power through faith. And we looked at last week how that sanctification, that setting apart, can have two distinct senses. One, definitive sanctification, the decisive one-time act of setting someone apart to God, often thought of as coinciding with calling or regeneration. And secondly, progressive sanctification, that work of God in the believer over time by which He makes them more and more holy. So with those two distinct understandings in mind, we began to see from our text how we are, one, sanctified by His word. Secondly, we are sanctified as His witness. And thirdly, we are sanctified through His work. Sanctified by His word, our witness, His work. Point one, we looked last week at how we are sanctified by His word. Literally, verse 17 reads, "Sanctify them in your truth. Your word is truth." And we saw how God's truth is both the word of the gospel by which we are set apart to Him, that's definitive sanctification, and God's truth is the means of God applied by the Spirit of God over time to make us holy. That's progressive sanctification. We are sanctified, set apart by His word. Now, point two, we began to look at last week, verse 18, to see how we are sanctified as His witness. We are sanctified to mission. Right? Verse 18 says this, "As you sent me into the world, I also have sent them into the world." Now remember, the biblical definition of sanctification involves not merely setting something or setting someone apart to God. It is setting them apart for God's use, for God's use. It is sanctification. When the Lord prays, "Sanctify them," He's praying that they would be set apart for His use. It's a dedication of duty. It's a consecration to commission, right? And that's primarily understood in the Bible as sacrifice. And I want us to make the connection, right? The tables, utensils in the tabernacle, for example, sacrificed for their common usage, set apart and sacrificed from that for holy use alone, could no longer be used for common purposes, must now only be used for God's purposes, for holy use. Deuteronomy chapter 15, verse 19, "The firstborn of your flock was to be sanctified entirely to the Lord." In other words, it wasn't to be used for anything else. Holy and entirely for the Lord. It was sacrificed as an offering to Him. That sense holds true for Christians. For the life of a genuine believer in Christ, you are sanctified or set apart wholly to the Master's use. Romans chapter 12, verse 1. "I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable to God, which is your reasonable service." That's reasonably expected, that you would give your life, your entirety, all that you are, to the one who gave all that He is for you. You are set apart to Him. "Tie me to the horns of the altar, God," right? "And when I have done all that I can do, when I've done everything that I can do, all I can say is that I am at best an unprofitable servant." A genuine disciple of Christ is set apart. They are sanctified to worship, sanctified to serve the Lord Jesus Christ in His mission. And that involves even a sacrificial death, if necessary, right? And we've seen that through the centuries, those that have given their lives for the cause of Christ. Now think about that. Think about that in terms of the Lord's Prayer in verse 18. "As you sent me into the world, I also have sent them into the world." Think with me about this. You profess to be a genuine disciple of the Lord Jesus Christ. That means that by that word which was preached to you, you were set apart to Christ. And you were set apart to Christ by the regenerating work of the Spirit of God. You weren't set apart just to look pretty. You're not set apart just to look holy, all polished up, right? You were set apart for the Master's use. And according to John chapter 17, verse 18, you were sent into the world. As you sent me into the world, I also have sent them into the world. That's the effect or the consequence of our sanctification. We were set apart, and having been set apart to Christ, we were sent into the world on a mission. Now the question is, sent into the world for what purpose? Sent into the world to what end? The answer to that question is found in that little word as that begins verse 18. As you sent me into the world, I also in same manner have sent them into the world. So for what purpose was Christ sent into the world? 1 Timothy chapter 1 verse 15. This is a faithful saying and worthy of all acceptance that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am chief. Jesus himself said, didn't he, of his mission, the Son of Man has come to seek and to save that which was lost. Now that means that just as Christ was sent into the world on a mission to save those whom the Father had given him out of the world, we have been sent on a mission into the world to continue his work. John chapter 20, verse 21, as the Father has sent me, I also send you. That's our mission. That's our mission. As Christ was sent, you've been sent. Can't be stated any more clearly. We've been set apart. We're a consecrated people, a living sacrifice. We're to preach the gospel and make disciples. The Lord continues the work that he began through his church. If you think about Acts chapter 1, when Luke's writing, he's writing to Theophilus, and he says, he writes of all that Jesus Christ began to do and to teach. And the story of Acts is how the church continues all that Jesus Christ began both to do and to teach. Now, if you notice that from verse 18, I want you to notice a few particulars with respect to that statement in verse 18. One is you are sent. That's clear. So now think about the implications of this, right? If you are sent in verse 18, then go. You're a Christian. You profess the name of Christ. Having been set apart by Christ, you've been set apart to mission. You've been sent into the world. Go. Go into the world. Go evangelizing. Be a witness for Christ. You're not planted in the world. You're sent to the world. You're not of the world, you're in the world, go to the world with the gospel. You are sent. You are sent. Secondly, in verse 18, it's the Lord of the church who sends you. You've been charged by the Lord Jesus Christ to evangelize to lost people in the world. As the Father sends him, he now sends you. What was Jesus Christ doing? Jesus Christ was constantly preaching. Constantly ministering, constantly preaching, ministering, making disciples. Thirdly, one, you're sent. Two, it's the Lord of the church sending you. Thirdly, you are sent into the world. You're into the world. As the Father has sent me, I also send you. You've been sent. If you profess the name of Christ, you've been sent. Let me ask you, are you going? Are you going? You've been sent. Are you going? Many today say and profess that they are Christians, but they don't go. They don't go. In other words, they say that they are a follower of Christ, and yet they do not follow him in his mission. There was a parable that immediately came to mind, the parable of our Lord in Matthew 21. Listen. Jesus Christ was speaking to hypocritical Jews. He was speaking to hypocritical Jews who said they believed God, but did not obey him as God. He says in verse 28, Matthew 21, what do you think? A man had two sons. He came to the first and he said, son, go work today in my vineyard. He answered and said, verse 29, I will not. But afterward, he regretted it, and he went. Then he came to the second, and he said likewise. And he answered and said, I go, sir. But he did not go. Which of the two did the will of his father? They said to him, the first. And Jesus said to them, assuredly I say to you, that tax collectors and harlots enter the kingdom of God before you. If you say you're a Christian, you've been sent. The command to evangelize. In line with verse 18, the command to evangelize applies to every single Christian. Every single Christian, every disciple of Christ has been sent into the world. To fail to go when you've been sent is sin. There may have been a time when you've said, I will not. You may be saying that in your mind right now. I will not. You call yourself a Christian, and you will not. But you've been sent. You've been sent. You've been set apart to this work. You've been set apart to this mission. You should regret that and go, like the first son. Repent and go. John chapter 17, verse 17, is the means of our sanctification, right? Sanctify them by your truth. Your word is truth. John chapter 17, verse 18, explains the mission of our sanctification. We are sent into the world. In the Christian life, right? In the Christian life, it's important to settle these things in your heart and mind because it takes conviction of these things for you to persevere in them, for you to begin them, right? For you to begin that work, which is often in this hateful, hostile world, not an easy work, right? We struggle with sin, attacks from within, attacks from without. We fear man, we're weak, we're often faithless, we often doubt. But in order for you to be committed to that work, you must be convicted of its necessity, of its importance. You have to be convicted in your heart that that's what God has called you to do in this world. You need to be convicted in your heart there are lost people who need the gospel, who need to be saved, that otherwise will perish. If you're not convicted by that, if you're not convinced in your own heart and mind about these things, convinced that the Lord Jesus Christ continues his work, the grace and mercy of God in Christ continues on the shoulders of his people, then you'll sit at home. You'll ride the bench. You'll stay back in the camp rather than getting out in the trench. Conviction about this is necessary to our commitment. It's necessary to our action. Praise God, this church represents, I think, a conviction about these things. Because we talk about them. We see them in the Bible. And not only do we see them in the Bible, we see a vast majority of those that would say they're evangelical that have no conviction about these things. What is it? You know, Barna study came out years ago that said that 98% of Christians didn't share their faith. Well, what that Barna study tells you, there are 2% of people who profess to be Christians who are Christians. Conviction about these things. You're not sitting here today because of some organizational flowchart. You're not sitting here today because someone dug a well for you or built a house for you, did some good thing for you in that sense. You're not here Christian today because someone built you a house. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. How shall they believe in him of whom they have not heard? And how shall they hear without a preacher? And how shall they preach unless they are sent into the world? And the Lord Jesus Christ in verse 18, as you have sent me, Father, I send them. This is what we see here today, right? And genuine, true, biblical churches around our country, around our world, is the fruit of a simple people sent on a simple mission with a simple message. And just like those 11 men faced the world, and we believe in Christ through their word, Look around us in this church today. And as Jesus Christ sent them, Jesus Christ also sends us. As Jesus Christ was sent, he sends us. And it's that message that has prevailed. Jesus Christ has promised, I will build my church. And this is a glorious testimony, isn't it? That he's done it and continues to do it. Martin Lloyd-Jones recounted an example of God accomplishing his work through Gideon. Listen to Martin Lloyd-Jones. It says, take the case of Gideon, right? A mighty enemy army was facing the children of Israel. And at first, Gideon collected an army of 32,000 people. Then God began to reduce them until in the end, there were only 300. God, in effect, said to Gideon, I'm not going to do this through that great army of 32,000. I'm going to do it in my way. So he just reduced the 32,000 to 300. And then he sent them out, not with great armaments, but with pitchers with lamps inside them, along with trumpets to blow. And with that ridiculous equipment, they conquered the army of the enemy. That is God's way. We don't have to sit back and envision all kinds of various methods and programs and organizations, and you just got to talk to somebody, right? You just got to talk to somebody. Go up to a lost person and share the gospel with them. That's the way it has been done. That's the way the Lord does it. So think about this with me. When the Lord prays for these men in John chapter 17 and praying for all other disciples after them, he's praying, right? He's praying precisely because he has given them this mission in a world that despises them for it. That's why he's praying. His petition that God would sanctify them is asking God to set them apart as a sacrifice in that work, that they would give their lives in that work. That's essentially the prayer that the Lord is praying here for them in John chapter 17. You and I are to sacrifice to pursue this mission, his mission in this world. We are to pursue it even to the sacrifice of ourselves. Point one on your notes, we're sanctified by his word. Point two, we're sanctified as his witness. And thirdly, we are sanctified through his work. We're sanctified by his word, sanctified as his witness, sanctified through his work. Through the person and work of the Lord Jesus Christ. Look at verse 19. Jesus prays, and for their sakes I sanctify myself, that they also may be sanctified by the truth. Now, John 17:17, the Lord prays for the Father to sanctify them, right? In other words, the foundation of our sanctification is the Lord Jesus Christ himself. He says in verse 19, for their sakes I sanctify myself. Now, as we consider what this means, we can immediately limit the sense of the word sanctification when the Lord uses that word of himself. He's already perfectly holy, right? The Lord Jesus Christ is perfectly sinless, and therefore he has no need of progressive sanctification, whereby he is made more holy, right? He's without sin. He's without spot or blemish. So what he's saying here in verse 19 then, speaking of sanctifying himself, he's talking about he has set himself apart. He has set himself apart. Think about the use of that word again, and think about it in terms of the Lord Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ setting himself apart entirely, wholly, right? For their sakes, I sanctify myself. I sanctify me. I set me apart entirely for God's purpose so that they may be sanctified. And think about the word sanctification and all that implies. He sets him, all of him, apart in sacrifice for the purpose and work that God has given him to do. He's giving himself over to be used of God for their sakes. And all that by the total, complete sacrifice of himself. And verse 19, for their sakes points to the work, the mission, the purpose for which he has been sent into the world to seek and to save that which is lost, right? He came to redeem those the Father had given him in eternity past out of the world. That word "for" there implies substitution. For them, for their sakes. In other words, Lord Jesus Christ set himself apart for his own, for his people, to save them. He is set apart, sanctified to save them. And when the Lord Jesus Christ sets himself apart to the Father's will to save sinners, in doing that, he sets himself apart to the sacrifice of the cross. All of that is wrapped up together, right? Wrapped up together. He, being sinless, being God, he being perfect, he submitted himself as a sacrifice for sin, that we might become the righteousness of God in him. It's a great text that I think exemplifies this. Turn with me to Hebrews chapter 10. Hebrews chapter 10. Hebrews chapter 10. Look with me beginning at verse 5. In Hebrews chapter 10, verses 1 through 4, our author here is making clear the complete inability of animal sacrifices to purify anyone. It can't be done through animal sacrifices. You can't purify anyone through the blood of bulls and goats. The blood of bulls and goats cannot take away sin. In fact, verse 3, the sacrifices that are made only serve to remind the people of their sins. Those sacrifices to point the people constantly to their sinfulness. It won't be through the blood of bulls and goats that anyone is forgiven of their sins. All of that is simply a reminder until Christ. Look at verse 5. Therefore, when he, Christ, came into the world through his incarnation, right? He said this, quoting Psalm chapter 40, verses 6 through 8. He said, "Sacrifice and offering you did not desire, but a body you have prepared for me. In burnt offerings and sacrifices for sin, you had no pleasure. Then I said, 'Behold, I have come. In the volume of the book, it is written of me to do your will, O God.'" And verses 5 and 6 there, Christ uses those four expressions, sacrifice, offering, verse 6, burnt offerings, sacrifices for sin. Those four expressions are a comprehensive umbrella under which the entire Levitical sacrificial Old Testament system is put, right? He's saying that that system, in its entirety, all of it is bankrupt as a means by which you can please God. In fact, verse 3, it's just simply to point you to the fact that you can't please God through the law, that you can't please God fully and finally through this sacrifice. All it can do, all that Levitical system can do, all of those offerings, all that they can do is only point you to the true and lasting sacrifice of the Lord Jesus Christ himself, right? When Jesus Christ sanctifies himself, sets himself apart to sinners through sacrifice, it's that. In that, it is taken away, right? That Levitical system taken away to make way for the once for all sacrifice of Christ himself. Look at verse 8. Previously saying, "Sacrifice and offering, burnt offerings, and the offerings for sin you did not desire, nor had pleasure in them, which are offered according to the law." Then he said, verse 9, "Behold, I have come to do your will, O God." He takes away the first so that he may establish the second. In other words, he takes away that entire sacrificial system, right? That entire system he takes away so that he could fulfill the will of God through the sacrifice of himself. He came to do the will of God, to do your will, O God, verse 7. "Behold, I've come to do your will, O God," verse 9. In doing the will of God, he takes away the first sacrificial system so that he could fulfill that will in redeeming his own people through the sacrifice of himself. Look at verse 10. "By that will," the will of God, we have been sanctified ourselves. We've been set apart. We've been sanctified through the offering of the body of Jesus Christ once for all. God's will from eternity past was to save a people to himself, right? To gift a people to the Son. Christ sanctified. He set himself apart. He sacrificed himself. Sacrificed himself to that will. He set himself apart in his incarnation to do the Father's will. In setting himself apart to the Father's will, he sets himself apart to the cross. And it is through that singular and perfectly acceptable sacrifice that we are set apart, that we are sanctified. Do you see? If you look at verse 11, and every priest stands ministering daily and offering repeatedly the same sacrifices which can never take away sins. But this man, verse 12, in stark contrast with all the Levitical priests, right? This man, after he had offered one sacrifice for sins, forever sat down at the right hand of God. Christ sitting down there is a sign. It's a symbol that his sacrificial work on behalf of sinners is finished. It's complete. And Christ sits down. And from that time, he sat down at the right hand of God. From that time, waiting till his enemies are made his footstool. Verse 14, and here it is. For by one offering, he has perfected forever those who are being sanctified. Now, if you meditate on that for a little bit and think about what the Lord Jesus Christ has done, that is beautiful. That is precious. It's amazing. Christ sanctifies himself, the perfect, spotless Lamb of God. He sets himself apart to the sacrifice of the cross to perfectly do the Father's will. And in sanctifying himself, he offers a single sacrifice, which is permanently and forever effective. As a consequence of that completed work, Christ has made his own people perfect forever. Awesome, right? Awesome. Something the priests could not do. Something the sacrificial system could not do. Something that the law could not do. Something that you cannot do. And yet it is accomplished by Christ's one sacrifice for sins for all time. And notice in verse 14 there that those for whom he sacrificed himself are described as those who are being sanctified. It's a passive participle. In other words, those who through his atoning sacrifice are through the ages being set apart to him. This is, what he's actually speaking of here is definitive sanctification. And that Christ, through his one sacrifice, through the sacrifice of himself, verse 14, perfects forever those who are being sanctified through the ages. So you link this back up with John chapter 17, right? He prays for his disciples. Verse 20, he prays for all those that would believe in him through their word. So all of those over the ages, down through the ages, who are being set apart to Christ, being set apart in the gospel to him, all those who are being sanctified, this one sacrifice for sins, by one offering, Hebrews chapter 10, verse 14, he has perfected forever all of those. All those who are being sanctified. His sanctification, right? His sacrifice, him setting himself apart, makes our sanctification possible. In other words, apart from that sanctification, there is no setting apart of his people. Back in John chapter 17, verse 19, and for their sakes I sanctify myself, that they also may be sanctified by the truth. He was set apart so that we could be set apart. Think about this in terms of the gospel, right? You were made by God. You're made by him. knit together in your mother's womb. He created you. He breathed life into you. Everything you have, your very being is from him. You are his. You're his possession. He made you. He owns you, right? He created you to be perfect. He created you to be holy, consecrated to him. He made you. He made you. He has the right to do anything with you that he wants to do. He has the right to rule over you. He has the right to reign over you. He made you. He made you to be consecrated to him alone, dedicated to him alone. He made you for himself, to be a display of his glory, a display of his attributes, holy, consecrated to him alone, dedicated to him. But you sinned. I sinned. And your sin, my sin, has separated us from God. Has destroyed the possibility of fulfillment within ourselves, that purpose for which he created us, apart from Christ. Look at the hurt and damage that sin causes, right? Look at the people that you hurt because of your sin. Look at the consequences of your sin. Look at this wicked world in which we live, all the fruit of sin. Your own guilty conscience bears this out. It accuses you that you are a wicked sinner. You have done wrong. You have sinned against God, sinned against your Creator. And listen, God hates sin. He hates all that is against himself. He will not tolerate it. He will not tolerate it. How can there be a sin in the presence of God? How can there be sin in heaven? There can't be. And you who have sinned, you will stand before your Creator when you die. And that comes so quick. When you die, it could be today, this afternoon, next week, next year. It comes fast. This life is a vapor. When you die, you will face accountability before God who made you. You will stand before your Creator one day, and what will you do about your sin? What are you going to do about your sin? And many of the people in this world, right, live obliviously to that fact. You will die, and you have no answer for your sin. You will stand before God, who is holy. You will have to give an account. What are you going to do about your sin? Jesus Christ was sent into the world. He set himself apart. He sanctified himself, set himself apart to the brutality, the tragedy of the cross. He perfectly obeyed the Father. He went to the cross as a sinless sacrifice so that you could be set apart and right with God. Are you going to thumb your nose and grit your teeth and turn your cheek to that sacrifice, to that act of love and mercy and grace? Really, are you going to rebel, reject that? Set yourself apart to him, right? Through repentance and faith, turn from your sin. Put your faith in Christ. Give your life entirely to him and he will raise you up. Allow me to make an application for my brothers and sisters in Christ here. This is matchless splendor, right? The work of Christ, the redemptive plans and purposes of God in Christ. It's beautiful. It's perfect. We have a responsibility, brothers and sisters, to pursue our perseverance and to pursue our sanctification, knowing that God in Christ has sanctified himself for our preservation and for our sanctification, right? If you think about John chapter 17, verses 6 through 19, the Lord Jesus Christ prays for two petitions, two things. He prays for our keeping, Father, keep them. And he prays for our sanctification, set them apart to yourself, consecrate them, right? If he prays to the Father for those things, that's God's sovereignty. Lord Jesus Christ is praying to the Father. The Father will keep his own, and the Father will sanctify his own. But that keeping, that preservation, and that sanctification, in both of those, the Father uses means to do it. And he uses the means of our own perseverance, uses the means of our own pursuit of sanctification in order to preserve us and to sanctify us. He does that through his word of God. He does that through prayer. Let me give you one example. Turn with me to Revelation chapter 3. Revelation chapter 3. In other words, by means of application, knowing that the Lord Jesus Christ has prayed this prayer in John 17 for you and for me, knowing that should fuel, should compel, should drive us to persevere and to be sanctified. We should avail ourselves of the promises of God here, implied in this prayer, to pursue our perseverance and to pursue our sanctification. And in doing that, we have to stick close to the source. We have to cling to Christ. Look at verse 14, Revelation chapter 3, verse 14. And to the angel of the church of the Laodiceans write, these things says the Amen, the faithful and true witness, the beginning of the creation of God, verse 15. I know your works, that you are neither cold nor hot. I wish you were cold or hot. So then, because you are lukewarm and neither cold nor hot, I will vomit you out of my mouth. And if you know the situation here at Laodicea, Laodicea was between two wells, two springs. The springs had to come a distance to get to Laodicea. One was a hot spring, one was a cold spring. From the distance that those springs were from the city of Laodicea, the distance that that water had to travel, by the time that it got to Laodicea, it was lukewarm. It wasn't hot, it wasn't cold. By the time it got to the city, it was lukewarm. He uses this as an object lesson to teach them something. He says then, because, verse 16, you are lukewarm and neither cold nor hot, I will vomit you out of my mouth. In other words, that lukewarm water, good for nothing. You can't drink it. If it were hot, you can make tea with it. Colombian coffee, right? If it were cold, it'd be refreshing. You could drink it. But because it's lukewarm, it's good for nothing but to be vomited out. Verse 17. The reason for their condition as lukewarm is here in verse 17. Because you say, I am rich, have become wealthy, and have need of nothing. And you do not see your need, right? You don't see your need. You don't know that you are wretched, miserable, poor, blind, and naked. The Lord says, verse 18, I counsel you to buy from me gold refined in the fire, that you may be rich, white garments that you may be clothed, that the shame of your nakedness may not be revealed, and anoint your eyes with eye salve that you may see. As many as I love, I rebuke and chasten. Therefore, be zealous and repent. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come into him and dine with him, and he with me. To him who overcomes, I will grant to sit with me on my throne, as I also overcame and sat down with my Father on his throne. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. In other words, you've been set apart. You've been set apart to God in Christ. Set apart to the Lord Jesus Christ. Stick close to the source. Stay close to the source. Cling to him. Avail yourself of all those means that God has provided for your perseverance, for your sanctification. Cling to the Word of God. Cling to God in prayer. Cling to the people of God. Cling to the church of God. Stay close to the source. You know in your experience, as well as I know in my experience, to my shame, there have been times when I am farther away from the source than I need to be, and I feel lukewarm. That is the feeling of death taking root in you. Cling to the source. Be close. Jesus Christ prayed that the Father would preserve us. So persevere. Cling to Him. Cling to Him and let the Father preserve you. Let the Father strengthen you, protect you, guard you, hold you. Right? Jesus Christ prayed in verse 17 that the Father would sanctify us. So pursue your sanctification. Pursue those means of God by which you will be made more and more holy. More and more holy, on fire for God, versus lukewarm, tepid, good for nothing but to be vomited out. You have to cling. You have to stay close to the source. If Lord Jesus Christ prayed these things for us, it should be driving motivation for us to cling to Him, for us to persevere, for us to pursue our sanctification. This is the will of God for you, right? Your sanctification. Stay close to the source. One of the ways that you stay close to the source is through that word that sanctifies you. Another way that you stay close to the source is in that mission to which you have been sent, verse 18, right? As the Father has sent me into the world, I send you into the world. Stay close to Him. Let's pray. Father in heaven, Lord, we praise you and thank you for allowing us the blessing of hearing, of entering into this prayer of our Lord in John 17, how you have, in our hearing, expressed such what are promises, because the Lord Jesus Christ has asked for them. We know, we trust, we are assured that you are able to keep that which I've committed to you until that day. We trust and thank you for it. Thank you, Lord, for allowing us the blessing of studying this prayer together and considering these things. I pray, Lord, we pray together to you in accord with our Lord that you would keep us, preserve us, guard us, protect us, help us, strengthen us, hold us. And God, you would sanctify us, that you would keep us consecrated in your work, in your will, doing your will as Jesus Christ did your will. That you would make us more and more holy, conform us into the image of your Son, help us to become more like Him, mature us, grow us, build us up in our most holy faith. Cause us, Lord, to abound in these graces for your glory. In Jesus' name, amen.